Good evening, everyone. It is great to be here with you again. As some of you who have been at some of the others of these lectures have heard me say on each occasion, this is just simply one of the great moments in the life of our college when we celebrate the remarkable accomplishments of one of our colleagues. And so it's my pleasure to welcome you to the Ann T. and Robert M. Bass Professorship in the Natural Sciences inaugural lecture. And we are here tonight to celebrate the accomplishments and to welcome into this chair Rachel Beane. So Rachel, congratulations. The professorship was created in 1998 by an anonymous benefactor who named it in honor of Ann and Bob Bass, who are business people and amazing philanthropists, particularly in the area of higher education. Rachel is the third holder of the Bass Chair, following Alan Tucker and most recently Nat Wheelwright, who are both Bass professors emeriti. Rachel is a profoundly gifted teacher and profoundly gifted scholar, and the ideal choice for this chair. She's been recognized for her inspiring teaching, both here on campus with the Sidney B. Karofsky Teaching Prize in 2004, as well as the winner of the National Association of Geoscience Teachers Nell Minor Teaching Award for, quote, exceptional contributions to the stimulation of interest in earth sciences, which she received just last year. She is also a leading scholar on the composition of volcanic rock and what it can tell us about earth processes. She has received 6 National Science Foundation grants, as well as grants from the Maine Space Grant Consortium, the Colby Bates Bowdoin Collaborative Faculty Enhancement Program, and Stanford University. And in 2017, she was selected as a fellow of the Geological Society of America. Rachel has published widely on her research into volcanic, metamorphic, and igneous rock. I did that pretty well, right? For a sociologist. In coastal Maine, Western US, New Zealand, Russia, Kazakhstan, and Greece. And has authored or co-authored articles in the journals Geology, the Journal of Structural Geology, American Mineralogist, Journal of Earth and Planetary Materials, the Journal of Geoscience Education, and the Journal of Geologic Society, London, among a number of others. Rachel is also a leader on our campus and in her discipline in issues of diversity and inclusion, particularly in the classroom. She is the author of an article currently under review by the Journal of Geoscience Education on the practices in geoscience teaching that support diversity and inclusion. Rachel received her undergraduate degree from Williams, which we will not hold against her, and her PhD in geologic and environmental science from Stanford. She arrived at Bowdoin in 1998, became a full professor in 2011, and since 2016, she has served also as the associate dean for academic and associate dean for academic affairs. As we all know, Rachel does amazing work here. And everything we ask of her, she does exceptionally well. Her teaching, her research, her scholarship, and yes, even the dark art of administration. She is deeply accomplished, widely admired, and an inspiration to all of us. It is my great pleasure to introduce the Ann T. and Robert M. Bass Professor of Natural Sciences, Rachel Beane.
Thank you, Clayton, for your generous introduction. And thank you, Bowdoin, for naming me to the Ann T. and Robert M. Bass Professor of Natural Science. It's truly an honor to have this. And thank you. As I look out, I see my neighbors, my colleagues, my friends, my students, past and present, and family. And I thank you all for joining me this evening. I look forward to sharing some of my research with you. This photo here is from Banks Peninsula in New Zealand, one of the field areas where I'm studying volcanoes. I chose this photo in part to acknowledge that the Earth's stories include connections between the atmosphere, oceans, land, and humans, as my colleagues and students in Earth and Oceanographic Science well know. In this photo, we see layers of black basalt that have been weathered and partially eroded away, leaving spires sticking out into the sea. This evening, of all the many aspects of Earth, I'll focus mainly on the land aspects, and specifically the rocks. I'd like to start this evening with a quote. It's from the book Reading Rocks, and it's by Marcia Bjornerod. She's a geologist and an educator at the Wisconsin Academy. Stone has an undeserved reputation for being uncommunicative. But to a geologist, stones are richly illustrated texts. Over more than 4 billion years in beach sands, volcanic ash, granites, and garnet schists, the planet has unintentionally kept a rich and idiosyncratic journal of its past. As literature, Earth's telling of its own story is an amateurish amalgam. But since it is the story of our dwelling place, of how we came to inherit this commodious home, it is arguably the one text that should be required reading for every Earthling, including all of you in the audience. And so this evening, we will read a bit from Earth's text. But first, I want to provide some context. And to do that, I'll read from another book. I'm going to read from Where Do Mountains Come From, Mama? Yes, it's a story I've read to my own children. It's by Catherine Morley, and I like how she presents Earth in it. Where do mountains come from? A little girl and her mother were taking a walk in the mountains. The mountains were so big, and each one looked so different. The girl began to wonder, where do mountains come from? Mountains form in many different ways. They seem like they've been here forever and will always be here. But over millions of years, mountains come and go. The older ones slowly crumble in the wind and rain and wash away to the sea. It happens so gradually that you can't see it. Mountains are forming right now in different places around the world. The surface of the Earth is like the cracked shell of a hard-boiled egg. Large sections of land and ocean are pieces of the Earth's broken shell. These pieces move slowly, and sometimes they rub and push against each other. When this happens, it can make mountains. What makes the pieces move? The center of the Earth is really hot. The rising heat moves the pieces very slowly. Maybe the length of your big toe in 1 year? That would be fast. But sometimes they move a few feet in a sudden jolt. That's when you feel an earthquake. Pieces of land can travel all around the world with tiny creeping movement over millions of years. For example, fossils of tropical plants and animals can be found in rocks that have traveled north. You can even find fossils of sea creatures at the tops of the tallest mountains. But why are the mountains so tall, Mama? Some of the tallest mountains grow where two pieces of land smash together. The land is crinkled, crunched, and folded, kind of like how cars get crunched up when they crash. Something different happens where a piece of ocean bottom bumps into a piece of land. Because the ocean piece is heavier, it gets scrunched down under the land, similar to when you shove a spatula under a warm cookie. When that happens, it creates lava, and the lava forms pointed mountains called volcanoes. It was time to go home, but the girl had one more question. Why does every mountain look different? Every mountain is different, with a special past, just like every child. If you look closely at mountains' rocks, you can discover its life story. So that pretty much sums up what I have to say. tonight, the stories we'll tell will be similar to the stories the mother told her child. There'll be stories of mountains forming, pieces of land moving, earth getting crunched and folded, and, yes, volcanoes. So, to begin our Earth tour, I want to share how I read Earth's text and my workflow as a scientist. The photo on the left here is from Stewart Island in New Zealand. Some of you asked what one of my favorite places was, and I have good memories of being on Stewart Island with both family, former student, and colleagues. And I begin many of my projects in the field. I take photos, I make measurements with a ruler and a Brunton compass, I take notes and make sketches in my yellow, almost waterproof, at least water-resistant, field journal. And I also discuss what I observe with students and with colleagues. In this particular photo, if I were discussing it with you, I'd say, wow, this is kind of a reddish iron-stained rock, and it's kind of brown, light tan, and it looks really different from this black rock here. And with a little more examination of the rock, I could say that this is a tan, coarse-grained granite, igneous rock of the type that dominates our continents. Into it is intruded another type of igneous rock, this black basalt, and over here as well. This is the type of igneous rock that underlies our oceans. Basalt is denser than granite, which is why in the "Where Do Mountains Come From?" story, the oceans are described as going underneath or subducting beneath the continents. So in addition to all of these observations and the notes I make in my field journal, I also remove samples of the rock. And some of these samples I have made into thin sections. And this is what I show you here. Thin sections are 30 micron thick, in other words, really, really thin, slices of rock adhered to glass slides. Just 1 millimeter of the rock expands to what you see from top to bottom here. I took this photo with a petrographic microscope. So what does that mean? Petro is rock, so it's a microscope that we use to look at rocks. That doesn't tell you a lot. So if I were to construct this microscope, as we've done more or less in my class this semester, you could pop out the two lenses of your polarized sunglasses. You'd put one sunglass lens, and then you'd put the glass slide, and then you'd rotate 90 degrees the other sunglass lens, hold it up to the light, add a magnifying glass, and, well, it's a cheap version, but essentially what a petrographic microscope is. And it's this amazing way of looking at rocks. It allows us to see colors and textures of minerals that we can in no way see while we're in the field. For example, as some of you mineralogists and geologists have already figured out, you can look at this and you know what the minerals are. Should I cold call? No? Okay. So these bright birefringent minerals with these nice 60-degree and 120-degree angles allows me to interpret that many of the minerals in the slide are amphiboles, which I'm sure my students would have answered. So what other steps are part of my typical workflow in my efforts to read rocks? In the left photo, Manlio, hi Manlio, thank you, is using Bowdoin's scanning electron microscope, housed in the new Roux Center for the Environment. Scanning electron microscope is kind of a mouthful, so we usually shorten it to SEM. In this photo, Manlio is collecting Cathode luminescence images. Okay, cathode luminescence is also a mouthful, so we shorten it to CL. Images of kyanite as part of the project that Emily Peterman is leading and that he, myself, and others are working on. So this pink, I don't know, it kind of looks like a diving fish to me. Image on the screen above the SEM is a kyanite grain. As we move across the slide, this diagram here, one of the very few graphs I'm going to show tonight, with its red peaks, is X-ray data collected on this SEM. So each one of these pieces that sticks out from the SEM is a different detector or instrument that we can use to read the rocks. So with its peaks at oxygen, sodium, aluminum, and silicon, I can interpret that this mineral is plagioclase, more specifically a sodium-rich plagioclase called albite. So let's continue moving across the tools that I use. Top right is an electron backscatter diffraction pattern from the SEM. It's a glimpse at the lattice planes, the crystal structure inherent in the minerals. It helps us to identify the mineral and to identify its orientation. For my first sabbatical that Bowdoin funded, I went over to Liverpool to learn how to use electron backscatter diffraction because there was really no one familiar with it in the United States at that time. I found it amazing, just a really neat way that I was able to read rocks in ways that I'd never been able before to read them. I will tell you that when I first collected, and this isn't my first one, but when I first saw these patterns emerge, I just was struck. I was like, yes, you're always told that there's a specific crystal structure to the minerals, but when you can see those lattice planes, it's really neat. So Bowdoin was the first liberal arts college to get an electron backscatter diffractometer after I wrote a grant and the National Science Foundation funded it. In the bottom right is a cathodoluminescence, or CL, image. The CL image lets us see textures and the patterns of trace elements in a mineral that are too low of concentration to allow us to use X-ray data as we had done here. The minerals shown here are plagioclase, and we'll return to this image later in the talk. So why do I keep mentioning plagioclase, and what is this mineral? It's the most common mineral in the Earth's crust. So I'm pretty sure that at some time or another, you all have seen it. It might have been in a rock so small that you couldn't tell, but it's in so many of Earth's minerals. So I share these two slides with the workflow to let you know that behind the stories that I'll share tonight is a lot of science. This evening, I won't share many graphs, nor stories of writing grants, nor efforts of hours and hours editing and rewriting and rewriting and rewriting papers. But I will share field photos and microscope photos, because they're fun to share. So let's start this evening's tour. We're going to start in North America. More specifically, we're going to start in Maine. So here's Maine. Not on a day, a beautiful sunny day like today, but rather on one of the cloudy days. And this image here is a NASA image from 2002. So within Maine, what do I want to share with you? I'm going to share the geology of Harpswell, because I felt like to tell a story, I needed to get specific enough that I could tell you the details of that story. But really, there's so many other places in Maine that have these amazing stories and that I love to tell. So we'll start at the Cribstone Bridge here in Harpswell, and then we'll move on to Giant Stairs in Harpswell. You'll notice that I've labeled some other things on this map. So this is Brunswick Landing with its treeless airstrip. We're here, okay? And then I've drawn a line between where Bowdoin College is and the name Bowdoin. And I've drawn this with purpose to draw your attention to this northeast-southwest line. Not the line I drew, but the orientation of the peninsulas, the islands that come jutting out of Maine into Casco Bay. We'll get back to understanding why this is in a few slides. So on to the Cribstone Bridge. This is part of an introductory course lab in the Investigating Earth class. The students are drawing sketches, making notes, observing the rocks. Beyond these sketches and observations, and based on geochemical analyses that Bowdoin students and I have done, we can interpret that this rock used to be a basalt from a volcanic eruption. And if we went around the corner of this B&B, we could see other material that isn't a basalt, but is a volcanic eruption, and perhaps ash or some felsic volcanic material from another type of volcanic eruption. But I'm using the word used to be very carefully, because this igneous basalt here was later metamorphosed. And when the students were looking at the rock closely, this is what they saw. They saw a metamorphic rock loaded with garnets and amphibole. So metamorphic is a rock that changed its state. So in this case, it used to be an igneous rock. And now we could call it an amphibolite. So these are garnets here. They're kind of pink in color here. These don't have the nicest dodecahedral format as garnets do, not even a round format like the garnet that I'm wearing, but rather they've been pulled and stretched from later tectonic activity. And then if you look closely, you might say, well, yeah, rock is kind of gray-brown, but I ask you to look at the colors just a little more carefully. You see some rusty iron tan weathering here, but here when I look at it, I see a blue-gray. And that blue-gray is due in large part to the amphiboles, the blue amphiboles that are making it up. Rocks have histories, and as a geologist, I work to decode not only what the minerals are now, but also what the rock was and the earth processes that formed it. In a sense, it's like being a detective, looking at clues in the rock and trying to come up with the most plausible story. So now I suppose I need to tell you a story. So, for the processes that initially formed the rock near Cribstone Bridge, the evidence points to volcanoes that erupted around 450 million years ago. So yes, volcanoes in Maine, absolutely. What about this? Maine in the southern hemisphere? So this is New England and Nova Scotia here. This is North America here. It's still pretty much in the southern hemisphere, maybe. But we're really far away from it. So what's happened? Well, there's plenty of evidence of volcanism around this time, around 450 million years ago. And there's lots of that evidence in Maine. So some of the rocks on Peaks Island near Portland, Cranberry Island near Acadia, and yes, to my Topsom friends, even Topsom. The volcanoes might have been similar to what we see on the Japan Islands today, or New Zealand. That'll be our third stop on this evening's tour. So to tell the story of how we might have started here and ended up over here, we need to go through a few more 100 million years. So around these volcanoes that were erupting near south of the equator were watery muds and sands. So I use the past tense were again, because these watery muds and sands are no longer muds and sands. They are now these beautiful, shiny, mica-rich metamorphic rocks. How many of you have been to giant stairs? How many of you need to go to giant stairs still? Yeah. It's an awesome place. I've heard some people say that the rocks at giant stairs look like petrified wood. From a distance, I agree. They actually are foliated, and that means layered, rocks that were tilted up when they were compressed and squeezed together, and they were folded deep within Earth's crust. So let's look at the orientation of these rocks. So we're looking northeast here. Do you remember that line I drew on the map where I showed Harpswell? And the line was going northeast, southwest for the peninsulas and the islands and the trend of those. Looks pretty close to these rocks here. The rocks are showing the same general trend as the peninsulas and islands that we saw on the image of mid-coast Maine. It's not just the rocks that are lined up. Many of the minerals are aligned too. We find in geology that across scales, we see some of the same features. There's some things that we can only see at the big scale, some things we can only see at the small scale, but there are many things that are repeated on different levels, on different scales. So in this photo, we see red garnet and brown staurolite, two different types of minerals, within light gray muscovite and plagioclase. Yep, there's that plagioclase again. The muscovite, some of you might know it better by the name of mica. Mica is a shiny, layered mineral, and it comes in two forms, muscovite, potassium aluminum silicate, and then biotite that adds in iron and magnesium into its formula. So in telling the story of Harpswell, we started with NASA's image of the whole Earth. And with each photo, I've been zooming in closer and closer. So let's zoom in one more step. I could really fill a whole presentation with microscope slides because I really love looking down a microscope at rocks. A whole new world opens up, and I find that I can lose myself in the beauty and the stories that they are telling me. So this is from that rock that looks like petrified wood at giant stairs. And here's what I see when I look at it. Again, remember that this is the rock, a thin section of rock, looked at as if you had popped out the two lenses of your sunglasses. These black circles here are garnet. And these brightly colored, layered minerals here are micas, both muscovite and biotite. When we take samples, we can orient our samples so that we can reorient them when we're looking down a microscope. And that's what I've done, is I've reoriented this so that they're showing the northeast, southwest, more or less, it's not perfect here, trend, the same trend that we saw in the rock foliation, the same trend that we saw on the peninsulas and islands of Harpswell. What else can we do by looking at this thin section? Well, if we turn from our petrographic microscope to a scanning electron microscope, we can analyze the chemistry of the garnet and the adjacent biotite. So students have calculated that the rock was metamorphosed, or heated and pressed, around 600 degrees Celsius. That's over 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. Warm summer days in Harpswell? Yeah, they don't reach anywhere close to 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. I think I'm pretty glad about that. So the metamorphism of this rock absolutely couldn't have happened at the Earth's surface. Instead, this rock was buried and metamorphosed deep within the Earth's crust. How far deep? Well, roughly the same distance as it is to drive from Brunswick to Bath. About 8 or 9 miles. So how did the muds and sands that surrounded the volcanic islands get buried this deep? We need to return to this book. I'm not going to read it to you again, just a reminder of what it is. So we need to think about plates moving and how mountains are built. So this slide looks different than the first Earth map slide I showed before. This one shows a projection of Earth as it would have looked 237 million years ago, after the continents had collided to form Pangaea. So where's Maine in this one? It's roughly about there, just under maybe where the A is in Pangaea. Or sorry, on the North America label. We started down here. Now we're up here. So continents have been on the move. And New England has moved from south of the equator to north of the equator in the intervening 200 million years. I really like John McPhee's books. I don't know if some of you perhaps have read them from time to time. I'll have to say it's kind of hard to choose one quote out of the many books on geology that he's read, but I'll quote a passage from his book, In Suspect Terrain. As Europe, Africa, and South America closed upon North America through Paleozoic time, those rode before them an ocean full of Javas, New Guineas, Borneos, Taiwans, and maybe hundreds of dozens of smaller islands. The Avalon Peninsula of Newfoundland appears to have been part of such an island, and the Carolina Slate Belt, and a piece of Rhode Island, and Greater Boston. And so following McPhee's description, it seems that Harpswell II was part of such an island, swept in, buried deep, and squeezed together during the closing of what was called the Iapetus Ocean. This closing of the ocean led to the amalgamation of continents that we call Pangaea. And while we have the slide up, I want to point out the Ural Mountains in Russia. We're not going through those quite yet, but that will be the second stop on our tour. First, we need to learn a little bit more about what's happening with Harpswell's geology. So what's next in Harpswell's history? Less than 100 million years passed after the continents closed to form Pangaea, when they moved apart again, this time forming the Atlantic Ocean. We can see evidence of this opening at Giant Stairs. So when people say Giant Stairs, in part they're referring to that whole section of marvelous coastline, and in part they're referring to the actual stairs that come down like this. So that metamorphic, petrified wood type of rock, that's what's coming along here, and it's continuing out here. And then cutting through that metamorphosed, layered, foliated rock is this basalt dike that splits the two. So if you recall, basalt is the igneous rock that forms much of the ocean floor. It forms and is pulled up into gaps and cracks during the melting of the Earth's mantle that forms this basaltic magma that comes through and splits open. These basalt dikes here and elsewhere are early precursors to the opening of the Atlantic Ocean. Elsewhere in Harpswell, we see other evidence of basalt dikes. So driving along Mountain Road near the town office, on the same side of the road as the town office, is a basalt dike. Look closely, you'll see a difference between the foliated rock and the more solid, blocky, more resistant basaltic dike. And then if you've been to Mitchell Field in Harpswell, just north of the pier is the same basalt dike as it's continued that far. So that particular dike is called the Christmas Cove Dike, and it's about 200 million years old based on geochronology. Geochronology is a way to date the age of the rocks. So if we put these pieces together and pull the story all together, we can see the continents have been in the move based on these projections here.
from times where Harpswell had volcanic islands, most likely related to the subduction of oceanic crust underneath another plate, to times where there was collision-related deformation, metamorphism, and intrusions of granite, such as the granite that you might see when you're at Popham Beach, and then an opening of the Atlantic Ocean with rift-related basalt dikes. So, from a history of fiery volcanic ashes, islands squeezed into North America, then coming apart again, we've told our first story. So what's next on our tour? I already said that we'd be going to the Ural Mountains. And as we transition, let me quote again from John McPhee. Most mountain ranges of the world are the result of compression of segments of the Earth's crust brought together, then mashed, thrust, and folded, squeezed up into the sky. The Himalayas, the Alps, the Appalachians, the Urals. So we'll go to the Urals, traveling from the Appalachians and the east coast of North America to the mountains in the middle of Russia. These mountains separate the European continental plate from the Asian plate. Both the Appalachians and the Urals formed as the continents squeezed together to form Pangaea. The main difference is that for the Urals, the continents didn't pull apart again. There wasn't an ocean that formed afterwards between the two plates. So images like this one here are a big boon for geologists. When I started my research in the Ural Mountains in the 1990s, there were no available images like this. There was no way to preview the terrain before I went into the field. And in Russia at that time, even once that I was there, I couldn't leave with any maps because they were all marked secret by the government. So instead, I had to make my own maps. I paced out the distance very deliberately with 1 meter steps, long steps. And I used a compass, and I noted the rocks that I saw at places along that way, and so I started my research. So I first headed to the Ural Mountains 3 weeks after receiving my bachelor's degree. I was very eager to explore a potential project for my PhD. So these photos here are from the field area in the southern part of the Ural Mountains. Just south of Magnitogorsk in the Chelyabinsk region, for Laura and others who are familiar with Russian geography. So I showed these photos not only to give you a sense of the field area, but also to emphasize that geology is a collaborative endeavor. And shown in these photos are an international group of my collaborators. We benefit as geologists from working out, trying to voice our ideas, having them criticized, or getting alternative viewpoints, making new hypotheses, and then taking those rocks into the lab and testing that whole suite of ideas that we have. The questions that we sought to address here were, how deep did these rocks get? And how long ago were they deep within the Earth? And what might this tell us about Earth's processes? So as we began in Harpswell, let's begin here with pictures from rocks in the field. And I've repeated some of the pictures from Harpswell. So these foliated, petrified wood type of rocks here, and the basalt dike here, and I've repeated them purposefully because in the Ural Mountains, we see some similarities. We see highly foliated gneiss here, and we see what used to be basalt in this Bowdoin, or this ellipsoid shape. And so you probably caught that I used the past tense again. I used used to be, because it's no longer basalt. Instead, it has been heated and compressed under really high pressures to form the rock eclogy. In the close-up photo on the left, we see the eclogite with its bright red, shiny garnets, surrounded by these green pyroxenes that mineralogists called omphocyte. So recalling that I went there just shortly after I received my undergraduate degree, I'd read about eclogite as an undergraduate. It sounded like a pretty cool rock, but the first place that I really saw it was in Russia. And it's such a gorgeous rock. You agree, right? Yes, yes. That I probably was hooked right there into studying it for my dissertation. On the right-hand photo is a green eclogite that has been partially altered. Altered by fluids, altered as it came up towards the Earth's surface, and formed blue amphiboles in a rock type called blue schist. So this photo on the top right, if you recall from the previous slide, the black mineral was garnet. This black, this time with a better dodecahedral shape, coming right here, is garnet here. And then these colorful, varied crystals around it are pyroxene, with some mica that's thrown in as well. By analyzing the ratios of iron and magnesium in the garnet and in the adjacent pyroxenes, I was able to interpret the conditions under which it formed. Or about 500 degrees Celsius, 2 gigapascals, at least 60 kilometers depth. So what does all that mean? And maybe it was even deeper, because there's evidence that others have found in these rocks of small diamonds that has subsequently been reverted to graphite. And then in the lower photo is an eclogite, but it's been partially reverted to a blue schist. And I show it to highlight these amber minerals in the center. This mineral is rutile. I crushed handfuls of rock to extract about 100 rutile that I could analyze to interpret an age for the metamorphism around 360 million years ago. But in this photo, the rutile is surrounded by a clear mineral. That mineral is sphene, or officially known as titanite. Yes, geologists use a lot of names. And what happened is that the pyroxene omphocyte reacted with fluids at lower temperature and lower pressures and formed the blue amphibole glaucophane. Well, in that process, calcium was liberated, and it reacted with the titanium in the rutile, and it formed the surrounding clear mineral. So these are the types of interpretations that I would make when looking down a microscope. And I share this one just so that you can see that thin sections of rock reveal many detailed stories, if we can take the time to read them. So what geologic processes would have formed this eclogite 360 million years ago and nearly 100 kilometers deep in the Earth? For giant stairs, we were comparing the distance that it was deep in the Earth to 8 or 9 miles, or about the distance from Brunswick to Bath. So for this comparison, I'll compare it to the distance driving from Brunswick south to Wells, much greater distance. So how can rock get that far deep? A subducting plate is the answer. This occurs when two of Earth's tectonic plates come together, and the denser plate goes underneath the other plate. For the South Ural Mountains, it was a portion of the European tectonic plate and smaller microplates that subducted eastward beneath the Asian plate. For this slide here, I'm showing the Pacific plate subducting or going underneath the Australian plate. I chose this slide because it gets us to our next location. So with this slide, we travel from Russia to our third story, New Zealand. So this diagram here was published in the New Zealand newspaper 2 months ago on the one-year anniversary of the devastating earthquake at Te Kaikoura on the South Island. The accompanying article in the newspaper was reporting on the possibility of an even bigger earthquake taking place. That possibility is real. New Zealand is very active geologically, with frequent earthquakes and volcanic activity. That's part of its appeal to a geologist, is that we can see the geology happening and feel it happening in real time. So what makes New Zealand such an active area? New Zealand is where this Australian tectonic plate is coming together with this Pacific plate here. They're moving, the two plates are moving towards each other. Here, the plate is subducting underneath the Pacific plate, separated by the fault here. And then here, this plate here is subducting underneath the North Island of New Zealand. So that's part of the complicated story and part of what it makes it so very, very interesting a place to look at for geology. So there's lots I could talk about in terms of New Zealand geology. But this evening, I'll focus on some of the volcanoes. So on this map, just above this word South Island, so Christchurch is located about here, and this is Banks Peninsula sticking out here. So this right here is Banks Peninsula, Christchurch is this way. Some of you, I know, looking out, have been to New Zealand, and so this is the Akaroa region here, in terms of getting oriented. So in this image, Banks Peninsula shows as rugged land jutting out from the rest of the coastline. So part of my last sabbatical, my family and I lived in Christchurch. And during our stay, we traveled to many parts of New Zealand. And during our travels, as we went from place to place, I was thinking, I wonder if this is what Maine and New England looked like 400 million years ago, with active tectonics, active volcanoes. And the rugged terrain that we see on Banks Peninsula here is a result of multiple volcanic eruptions. So staying on Banks Peninsula, this is a photo I took while doing research on the Akaroa Volcanic Center. It looks southeast towards one of the volcanic centers. This particular volcano is no longer active. Its last eruption was about 8 million years ago. 8 million years ago is really young, given geologic timescales. So the rock is fresh, not altered. That makes it really good for studying. The question I sought to address was, how do volcanoes erupt? Okay, so maybe that question is just a little bit too broad. So I'm really focusing on how is melt extracted from underground magma chambers in ways that lead to volcanic eruptions. And when I say melt, I mean rock that has gotten so hot underground that it has melted. The problem is, how do we study the underground magma chambers and relate them to the volcanic processes above ground? This block sketch here is if we could go to the Akaroa, Banks Peninsula area, and take out a big chunk of that land. So at the top are volcanoes, in keeping with our Akaroa story, they would be 8 million years old at time one. After tens, or maybe hundreds of millions of years pass, this top layer here will have been eroded, leaving at the surface the middle layer. And after more millions of years, erosion would have further taken place, and so that we would see what's here, or the underlying crystallized magma chamber. So if the volcanoes are active, or recently active, we see only the volcanic output, not the magma chamber. If the volcanoes were active hundreds of millions of years ago, then the volcanic material might be mostly eroded away. And we would be left seeing only the former magma chamber, now crystallized. That would be like the Cadillac granite in Acadia, would be that lower part, that crystallized magma chamber part. So if we want to link what's happening in the magma chambers underground with the volcanoes above ground, we have a problem. We might be able to find areas where there's just the right balance of erosion to preserve some of the volcanics and see the magma chamber. This is what I've done in some of my studies in Arizona and Colorado. Or, alternatively, we might be able to find pieces of the magma chamber exploded to the surface of the Earth with the rest of the volcanic material. This is our approach for New Zealand, where the volcanoes are too young to have been eroded down to the underlying magma chamber. We call the fragments of underlying magma chamber that have exploded outwards with the volcanic material plutonic lithics. Plutonic, from Pluto, god of the underworld, because they started in underground magma chambers. And lithic, simply meaning rock fragment. So in this photo, the plutonic lithic is this white piece here. There's long, white minerals that are, yes, plagioclase, once again. We know that this rock here, this part of the rock here, crystallized beneath the surface of the Earth because the grains are relatively big, at least much bigger than the basalt that surrounds it, that's so fine-grained we can't pick out individual crystals. So when rock cools and crystallizes underneath the surface of the Earth, deep within the crust, there's warmth there. And that warmth allows the minerals to continue to grow longer and bigger than the quick cooling that happens when the same type of magma is erupted at the surface and you get a lot of fine crystals that are happening. So that's how we know that we have part of the underground magma chamber here and part of the exploded volcanics here. The trick is, this isn't really big compared to a magma chamber. So magma chambers are often kilometers and kilometers or miles and miles wide. And here we have, you know, an inch, 2 inches wide sample that's here. So we need to look at a lot of these in order to be good detectives and tell our story. So we have measured and noted the composition of hundreds of plutonic lithics from Akaroa on Banks Peninsula. Many of these lithics were exposed as a result of rock fall along these cliffs that I show here. You can see places that would have had solid rock, and that rock has tumbled down, and then there's lots of boulders of rock underneath it. So these rock falls happened 8 years ago during the Christchurch earthquakes. The Christchurch earthquakes caused the central business district, in particular in Christchurch, as well as some soft sediments elsewhere, for all the buildings basically to collapse or become unstable. And they're still rebuilding in Christchurch from this. But the earthquakes also released pieces of these rocks from the cliffs, and we wouldn't have found the plutonic lithics without the fresh pieces exposed from this earthquake activity. So in a sense, it's made our work easier as well. This is the most data-rich slide that I'll show, probably. So what did we find out from these plutonic lithics? So these images shown here are from Bowdoin graduate Elizabeth Teeter, who completed an honors project with me last year. In the left-hand column are the microscope images, the light microscope images. In this middle column are cathode luminescence images. So I'll talk about this data first, and then I'll move on to the interpretation. So I've only shown two of the kind of hundreds of plutonic lithic samples that we at least measured in the field. We didn't make that many into thin sections. So I've shown the two M members of what we found. For this rock here, we saw some of the plagioclase you could kind of see had elongated view, but most of it, there were smaller pieces. They're kind of randomly oriented. And then when we looked at cathode luminescence, we could see things that we could not see in the light microscope. So one of the first things that we observed, and that I admit that I was a little bit confused by initially, was that these plagioclase crystals were seemed rimmed by this white material here. So taking some geochemistry and looking at it further, we determined that this white material that went around it was likely melt in the rocks that's now crystallized, but it crystallized late. And so it didn't have the same pattern as the larger plagioclase grains had. So then let's look at the other end member. So in this image here of from the light microscope, the plagioclase grains are the gray and black or black and white grains here. And I'm going to trace out a few of them here. So many of them are elongated. And in this particular photo, it's not oriented because there's no sense in orienting a plutonic lithic that's been exploded into the ground because it doesn't show its right orientation anyway. But for these here, they're elongated, and most of them are elongated and aligned. And then when we look in cathode luminescence, we don't see the same pattern. We don't see any of the white interstitial melt in between things. The black minerals here are primarily pyroxenes that are shown here. They don't luminesce under an electron when they're stimulated by electrons. So what does this mean? Why is there strong alignment and no melt here, and little alignment and lots of melt surrounding the grains here? So the column on the right shows our interpretation. This is a sketch by Liz Bertolette. She's a PhD student working in Christchurch and with whom I've been working. So we interpreted that the lithics with the aligned plagioclase and no melt were extracted from material at the bottom of the magma chamber. And that at the bottom of the magma chamber, those minerals had been compressed by the weight of the overlying material that allowed them to line up, and that compression also squeezed out any of the melt that would have been present there. Kind of like if you're squeezing something and there's a sieve and the liquid's coming out on the sieve. And then we interpreted from the top images that the lithics without aligned plagioclase and with crystallized melt rims were extracted from the top of the magma chamber. So we think that through compression of the material, it releases some of the melt upwards, and that released melt can lead to a volcanic eruption. So this is an ongoing project. Part of it, Elizabeth, Liz, and I, along with some collaborators at the University of Canterbury and Christchurch, are planning to submit for publication this summer. And other parts of it are still ongoing to try to figure out more of the details than I've shown here. Thanks, Karina, for taking this picture. I have a similar project on New Zealand's North Island in the Taupo volcanic zone. This volcanic zone is still active, and many of the rocks are even still warm as you go hiking in parts of the area. So unlike the 8-million-year-old Akaroa volcanic center on the South Island, this volcanic center still has active parts to it. So Bowdoin graduate Karina Grader and I, who's in the audience, published a paper on this a few years ago from the rocks and pieces that had been extracted from the Taupo volcanic zone. And so we need to look at many different pieces in different areas to be able to really tell Earth's story. Looking at one single area only gives us part of the story, because the Earth, in its own storytelling, in its own record keeping, has been incomplete. Ocean waves, water, rain, all of those things have eroded away parts of the story. It's like taking a book, and you're ripping out half pages some places and whole sections other places, and then you're trying to read that story. And so comparing multiple places, as we've done tonight, as we've moved from Maine to the Ural Mountains, to New Zealand, helps us to tell this story. So from geologic stories of New Zealand, Russia, and Maine, as well as many other locations, we can learn much about Earth. I'll quote again from the book, Reading the Rocks. We know that over geologic time, the face of the Earth has changed ceaselessly, and yet, on the whole, has been a remarkably hospitable place. We know, too, that the rates of human-induced changes in some of Earth's systems equal or exceed those associated with the most devastating geologic catastrophes. As humans, what might we do to leave a more distinguished entry in the geologic record? For a start, we can spend more time conversing with existing rocks. And maybe rocks can help us to discuss complex environmental issues and to instill in children an appetite for understanding deep origins and histories. End quote. So I hope the stories that I've shared this evening have helped you in some small way to appreciate Earth's history. And I hope that the next time you find yourself hiking the trails, exploring the coast, or driving along, that you will think a bit about the Earth and its amazing beauty and wonderful stories. Thank you. A couple microphones out, and so if someone wanted to ask a question, they're available to you. Or we can leave it at that, and then we can sit down and we can all leave.
I have lots of questions about the Earth. But I just wanted to ask you one question. As we know, many of Earth's most exciting stories are eroded or destroyed from the record. So is there one moment in time that you wish you could go back to actually see some of those things happen?
I think I would go back to the Paleozoic. So if you look at the stories that I was telling and the metamorphism that was happening as continents came together, that time in the Paleozoic, when Pangaea was formed, when the Ural Mountains were formed, when Appalachia Mountains were formed, to me that's a really interesting time when all those continents came together, when the pieces collided, when some went under the others. And we have just enough erosion since that time that we can get a glimpse and an idea, but not enough that I feel that we can tell the whole story. Or maybe we have the story mostly right, and I'd like to know how far off are we? And so that's the time that I would go back to.
What story do you want to tell next, and where would you go to tell it?
Sorry?
What story from Earth do you want to tell next, and where would you go to tell it?
Ah, that's a good question. I'm pretty involved in these volcanic stories right now. And I would like to look at it both in Maine by some of the places that we have both the underground volcanic rock and the volcanic rock exposed. I'd like to look at places where they might be connected and they might not in Maine. So that's a more easy place, right, because it's close. I'd love to go back to New Zealand, again, because it's an active analog or more recent analog in terms of what's happening. And I think there's a lot of stories that I still have to tell that are from that area. I don't think I've touched the surface of what's to be told there. Hi, Manlio.
Hi. Could you share your favorite mineral? And it cannot be albite.
And not what?
Not albite.
Not albite?
No plagioclase.
No plagioclase at all?
Maybe no garnet either, because I know there's some garnet fans.
Garnet was going to be the one because I'm wearing a garnet.
But besides those two.
But can I tell you about this garnet instead?
Yes, but then pick a third.
So this garnet is from Kazakhstan, and it's from an area where there are microdiamonds, and that rock was so deeply subducted. It's also one of the places Kazakhstan is where a sample that Emily and I are looking at of kyanite. And this garnet, there are these big garnets that you could find just kind of on the side of the stream beds. And this particular one I gave to my mom, just thinking, hey, her birthday is in January. It would be a nice birthstone gift. I didn't know that she was going to make it into a necklace, and that later, after she passed, that my dad would give me this necklace. And so it's special to me in that way. And it's hard for me to move away from garnet or plagioclase as being my favorite mineral. So can I go to kyanite?
Sure.
Okay. Hi, Ellie.
Hi, Rachel. So when you're talking about the eclogites, you're looking at like 60 kilometers down. Like, it can't just be erosion that's exposing these rocks. No, it
very means, good. That would be an awful lot of erosion.
Can you just like talk a little more about how these rocks get back up?
Yeah. So I kind of left this deep metamorphic eclogite type of story at the time when I feel like some of this was being figured out. So if we have one plate that is subducted underneath another, some of the ideas that, yeah, we can't just erode and move away all of that. We actually need in some way to be able to pull up, or that these rocks that have been pushed down deep are actually not at their density equilibrium and rather belong further up towards the surface, and that this subduction moment can also move them up in ways. We have to involve a lot of faulting, a lot of earthquakes probably, and a lot of motion to happen. But it's easier to see that happening than just eroding away 100 kilometers of rock, because where would it go?
Rachel, thank you so much for coming and sharing with us tonight. I really appreciate it. I definitely want to go out with an ice pick right now and find like all the rocks to look at. But I feel like I was like a really inside kid, and I feel like I came to EOS when I was here because I really loved going outside and just looking at Maine. So I wonder what your advice would be for a young person who is going out and looking at these stories, or a lifelong learner, and feels like they want to explore more deeply than kind of having that one-on-one conversation with rocks that they encounter in their daily life.
I'd find a partner. So when do you want to go out and look at the rocks together? I'd love to go with you. Really, I feel that the conversations that take place between people when they're looking at the rocks, you'll notice things. Even if we went to Giant Stairs, which I can't even count how many times I've been there, you will definitely notice something that I have not observed before. And in doing so, you'll allow me to tell a better story. And then I can share some of what I know with you. So really, I feel like the best way is to find someone and go out together. And they don't even need to know much more than you. You just need to be able to share some of your observations and start thinking about it. The next place I'd go is, you might have guessed that I like to read. And so picking up, whether it's the Roadside Guide to Geology in Maine or whether it's John McPhee's book, and seeing how some of those stories are constructed, and then looking at those and thinking about them when you're next on the rocks. It will open your eyes to some possibilities of the stories that surround those rocks that you might not have otherwise seen. The other hint I have is that, we have the state geologists, hi. That many state geology, as well as the USGS, the United States Geological Survey, publish geology maps. And there's good descriptions of the rocks there. And they're parts, enough accessible parts of the story that you can begin to piece together. So if you have that along with looking at the rocks, you can strengthen your own confidence and ability to begin to tell more of your own stories.
Awesome. Thank you very much. I'll see you next weekend at Giant.
Hi, Chuck.
How are you?
Good.
Good. I don't dare ask you a scientific question, so I thought I would ask you a teacher question.
Okay.
And so refer back to some of the things that Clayton had mentioned about your accomplishments during his introduction. What have been or what currently are the teaching practices in your field that you're most excited about? And how have you seen those changes for the positive in the time that you've been in the classroom?
Yeah. So I think some of the most exciting processes is that very rarely do I stand here and lecture for any length of time in a classroom. Usually there's a lot of learning, and you probably saw little bits of that gasp out when I wanted to ask you a question, or I did ask you a question. But we look at the rocks, we bring them in, we bring in models, we bring in maps. And so that kind of active practice, and I've seen that increasing. So I remember when I came to Bowdoin that someone had walked past my classroom and said, "It sounds like a cafe in there. What are you doing? Why are you how are you teaching?" And it was because all the students were chatting and talking. And I'd say at least in our department, that's probably the norm. That's what happens a lot of the time when we're doing things, when we're studying, when we're doing geology. So that's something I'm really excited about. I think we've done a better job in telling our stories too, of connecting to what people might know or what experience, what varied experiences that we all bring, and appreciating those varied experiences to how they might help us to tell our story better. And I think that as a field in geoscience education, that we're doing better at that and better at getting different viewpoints in, which only helps us then to tell our stories in a better way. So I'm not seeing more people stand up. So thank you very much. It's been really fun to be with you tonight.